So I'm very pleased to be here today, and I was invited to give a talk here. And I'm impressed by all the people here and how vibrant the data science community in Kiev is. We have a data science community in Amsterdam, the Amsterdam Data Science, which is following a similar model, but as I said, it's very vibrant and very active here as I see it today. So I'm going to talk about some of our work we have been doing over the last years, where we'll look at social multimedia, but try to, but using kind of non-standard techniques to look at them. So, but for starting, look at how the web and how media have developed over the last 20, 25 years. So when I did my PhD, well, when I finished my PhD in 1993, that was actually when the World Wide Web started. Before that, the World Wide Web didn't even exist. But that was the moment when the Mosaic browser appeared, which was the first way to browse the web and see what was there. So Google only arrived in 1998. So then all text data was possible to search through. You could find things on the web. And then in 2000, something else happened. And that's not that the mobile phone came about, because the mobile phone had been there way before. But it was the first phone which actually had a camera. And that was something that really changed how we are thinking about data, how we're working with data, and what is happening at the web now. So in 2004, the Flickr platform was started by Yahoo. And there, people could bring their photos, share them with other people. People comment on it. People could tag them. People could have users connecting to them to work with the data. So really, we now have a community of photos on the web with a lot of people around it. And the similar thing happened in 2005 with YouTube, where, again, a community around video and a lot of things to find there. Well, everybody knows that the amount of video there now is much more than anyone would be able to watch, even if you would watch 100 hours every second. Then in 2006, Twitter came about, and there was a platform where you could start talking about things, where items would be presented to the world, it would be shared. But there it is, text with a little bit of images, a little bit of video. So text is the main platform you're talking about. And then 2010, things changed, because then Instagram came about, which has a kind of similar role as Twitter, but now everything starts with the image and everything is connected to it. So everything you add in Instagram is added to the image rather than having a text where you add some images. So images and video are becoming more and more important on the web as a medium to work with. And that really changes how you can look at your media. So this is a picture from Flickr in this case. And when you have a picture on Flickr, it's not only the picture itself, but there's so much information around it. It tells you the geolocation, it tells you this is Amsterdam, where I'm from, it gives you exif information, it gives you who actually made this picture, it has some tags, very simple ones, so that it's a cyclist, that there's a bike there, there's a street there, and people can comment on it. So there's a lot of information around this particular image that we are talking about. So what it means that if you have social multimedia, if you have image or video data on the web, it's not only the image, but it has a lot of connections to other information on the web. So what kind of information could that be? Well, it could simply be a hyperlink, so from a web page to another web page. It could be people that are using the same tags, so where are the same tags used for a particular type of image. It could be your friends, people you connect to, they could be interesting to you. It could be things that were shot at the same location, that were all in Amsterdam or in the same time period. But you have more than just the pictures. You have all the connections between them. And those are exactly the things that we would like to leverage when we are starting working with social multimedia. So The other major event that was happening in 2012 was the AlexNet. Everybody working on deep learning, of course, is very familiar with that. So what does the AlexNet do? It takes an image. It uses the fact that that locations in an image, the content there is much related. So you can share things over different elements, and different elements that are close to each other, they will reinforce one another. They will help you to understand what's in the picture. And then, of course, you have all those layers helping you to get an understanding, and in the end, being able to classify an image like the one I was showing, telling there's a bike there, that there are buildings there, that there are streets there. But the major thing, the major observation that you are using here is that you have connections within the image which help each other to understand what is in the image. And some of them are at low scale, so some of the information is captured here, and some of the information is only captured in the higher levels of your deep learning network. But you bring those things together when you're starting to do analysis. But then people realize that a lot of the data that you are looking at when other data sets than images are not about the image data, they're not about the pixels, they're not about a nice rectangular grid of pixels, but they are relations which are captured in a graph. So social networks, so who is connected to whom, is not on a regular grid on which you can work. No, they are graph-based data sets. Networks in biology, how they regulate different elements. In your brain, how are all the things connected? How are they steering each other in all ways? 3D shapes, they are kind of a regular grid, but they're not really a rectangular grid. But what they have in common is they are a network. They create a graph on which you have to do your analysis and try to get some understanding. And that's how the convolutional neural nets came to say, well, this is not enough. It's not enough to just look at rectangular grids. We also have to look at grids like this. And that's when graph convolutional networks started to appear as a new mechanism to not only learn from images, but use the similar kind of techniques that bring them into graphs. And that's the basic idea coming from Thomas Kiepf, one of the PhD students at our university, but a very famous paper, where he used this technique to do classification of images, of graph-based data, of graph-based data. And what's the basic idea? You have a graph as input, where you see they are connections, and in the same way how you use a neural net, a standard convolutional neural net, where you look at neighboring pixels, you now look at neighbors that you have here. So the neighbors here will influence one another, but not on a rectangular grid anymore, but now at in the graph. And you can have multiple layers, you have the same kind of units that you now see in modern networks. And he uses two layers. Of course, you can build multiple layers on top of it. So in the output that you have is still a graph, but with the difference that you now have additional information on every item within my graph, and the additional information is what you have gathered from your neighbors around you. So at every step, what is happening, here I have four elements, and those three neighbors of this element update what I have here. So they tell you something about the element that we are looking at. And that's what is propagating, and in the end you have, of all those nodes, additional information that you didn't have before. And additional information, information from your neighbors, is a very important element when you start doing understanding of images. So probably if I ask you what this picture is, you probably have no idea. Does anyone know what it is? A flower with water. How do you know? Because you have seen the picture before. No, but it is actually a picture of a flower. But if you look at the image, it could also be a piece of fruit with some water on it. It could be maybe an octopus tentacle. It's very difficult to see from just looking at this particular image that you have. But if you know more about this image, if you know the embedding where this image is coming from, so if you have other images which are annotated with the same tag, or if you have images posted by this particular user, or if you have images which were taken from the same location in the same time period, or they are submitted to the same group on Flickr, the same kind of forum where people are working, you might see, you might find pictures like this, and yes, then you know what this picture is most likely about. So the contextual information tells you a lot about what is happening within the image that you're looking at. And that's exactly what you want to use. And that's another timeline which is of importance and which are things that have been happening over over the years. So a long time ago, so 1973, people started thinking in terms of hypergraphs. So now you talk about, we talked about graphs, but if you took, if you go back, people started talking in terms of hypergraphs, and they play an important role in the things that I will be talking about. And then in 2005, here, people started using graphs as a representation to do reasoning, and already at that moment, they started using neural nets. So this was way before 2012, so way before the deep learning start, but there's a lot of information there using neural networks, and they looked at images like this. So they started to combine neural nets with more symbolic reasoning on data. So it's really a combination of the two elements. Didn't work that well at that moment because the techniques were just not good enough. Well, of course, in 2012, as we said, AlexNet came about, so the deep learning kind of revival. It was already there before, but then it became really popular when people have used it on ImageNet. So really starting to explode in terms of papers and in terms of methods that are presented. And then in 2014, there was another seminal paper when people started to treat graph-based problems, so things that are operating on graphs, but starting to see them as something where you could do kind of traditional signal processing. So taking a different field, bringing that into the field of graph-based analysis, and that's when people started to create graph convolutional neural networks. The graph convolutional neural networks. But that came about because they started using signal-based processing as a technique. So in 2017, this method by Thomas Kiepf and Max Welling came about. So using a graph to do semi-supervised classification. So if you know some elements of your graph, some nodes in your graph, can you use them to predict whatever is there? So that was the basic picture we were just showing. And then last year, we started working on, well, we started working on it before, but we published on the topic where we kind of took the techniques that were here. So using the hypergraph-based model for data, connecting it to the kind of techniques that were here, and seeing whether that would bring any additional information, any additional benefit in doing analysis. So what is a hypergraph? So a regular graph, of course everybody knows, you have a set of nodes and there are connections between the nodes. You have the vertices and you have the edges, and that's your graph. So a hypergraph is similar, but rather than having only a connection between two elements, a hypergraph can be a connection between an arbitrary number of elements. So in this case, it could be this one particular element. So this is an edge now, so you really have to rethink how you think in terms of edges, because here an edge could be drawn as a line, here it's just one element that you're looking at. This will be another edge, just combining three different elements out of my data set. It could be those three elements, and you see that those groups can actually overlap. The edges can have elements in common. It could also be the whole graph. So all the nodes in my graph could be one big hyperedge. So the notion of a hyperedge is quite different from how you think of a graph, but it has some similar properties that you can explore, and of course that is what we try to do here. So this is the main formalism that we are employing within our idea. So how do you store such a hypergraph? Well, there are different ways of doing it, but what you typically do is use an incidence matrix. What does that mean? I have my nodes, I have all my possible hyperedges, or all the hyperedges in my system, and I just say, is vertex one, is that part of hyperedge one or not? Well, in this case, it's part of the first one, it's not part of the second one, it is not part of the third one, it is part of the fourth and the fifth one. So when you look at this, you can basically say it's not looking at edges, it's not looking at relations between elements, but it's far more looking at groups in your data. And the nice part about groups and the nice part about hyperedges is that they actually can also model the graph, but in addition, also have all the communities, all the group structure of your data encapsulated within this one particular matrix. And how can you use them? What are the examples? For example, if we have multimodal entities, so we have images, text, and users, the typical thing you have on Flickr, the thing you would have on Instagram, you can have groups for your users, they are connected. You could have groups for your text, groups for your, these are the images, groups for the users, but you can also have single links between them. So the single links are the kind of standard graph-based paradigm, and the groups are within those elements. If you look at a social network structure, so imagine all the users on Facebook or all the users on Instagram. They are connected by friends and all the things that they have. And it's known that that's a so-called scale-free networks. It is composed of communities where the communities are again connected to one another. So again, a hypergraph is a good representation to look at this kind of data. You have the same thing here where they look at tweets, users who are retweeting things. We have the same hashtag. So again, you can create relations between those different elements based on what kind of information they are sharing. And what we aim to do within this work is take a large amount of images. We have all those relations. So we have relations because they are labeled in the same way. They're relations because they have the same tags. You have relations because they are part of the same group. So the same community of people on Facebook or Flickr or Instagram. And there are relations between users. So we have those four different relations associated with every picture. And what we aim to do is take one of the relations. So we use the group relations and use the group relations to be able to say what are the labels, what should be the labels for an image for which I don't know the label. So we're trying to leverage some of the structure that we do have to say something about the structure that might be missing. And that's the idea of what we are trying to achieve here. And if you look at it, it came from the kind of hypergraph ideas, but you can also look at it from a different way as a matrix completion problem, where you say, I have a matrix. In this case, it's a set of images and a set of labels. So the image, does it have a certain label, which is a high-level description of the image? So for every image, you say yes or no whether it's available or not, or whether it has that label or not. So this would be, in practice, a rather sparse matrix. So only every element will have some labels, but not many, and that's what you are looking for. So what's the ID of matrix completion, you have this matrix with all those sparse entries. So a number of elements are filled. Those are the things you know. And can you complete the matrix? So can you add additional elements that probably should be there, but currently are not present within your description? And that's what we try to do here. So in this, for this image, you have all those relations. Part of it you know, part of it you don't know, and you see whether you can add more labels based on what you know about other images within your data set. And what you need to do, in this case, coming from the recommendation field, because the recommendation field is very much related to what we are doing here. So in this case, you have a graph of movies, you have a graph, you have movies and you have users, and you have a relation between users who have watched or who have preference for certain movies. So that's the matrix that you have. But on top of that, you also have a structure telling you how are those elements related. So how are the users related? How are the movies related? So you have two graphs, and you kind of combine them into one matrix. And that's the matrix that you kind of want to fill. So that's where you want to find entries, and that's the recommendation ID, of course. This user has watched this movie and that movie, and based on its relations, you want to recommend that one. That's the idea of the recommendation engine. And in this paper, again, rather recent, in 2017, they came up with the idea of multi-graph convolutional networks, where they are taking multiple graphs, like the ones that I was showing, so between movies and between users, and come to this idea that you can actually consider the problem of understanding what is in the matrix, doing the matrix completion, that you can see that as a signal processing problem. So that's where the spectrograph theories come in. And that's a technique that I have applied there and which we in a different way also apply. So what we are trying to achieve within our system? So we have this is our first input. So we have a set of images, a large matrix of images, where we have some relations. So we have this partially labeled graph, the one that we want to complete. And in addition to that, we have another graph. In this case, so those are the labels, so the high-level descriptions. Those are the tags, so just things people have added to a picture. We take this as another graph, so the relations between the elements, and from that we learn a model. So we learn a model based on what we know here from the additional relations, what we partially know about the data, so all the things that we have added and the things that we have that we know, and from that we try to complete the graph that we have here. So we want to add relations, add labels to this image based on the fact that those neighbors here had similar tags. And based on the fact that the neighbors had similar tags, we say that this one also should be in the group city life, so should have the high level label city life, although the label city life was at that moment not attached to this particular image. So we try to use the additional structure to say whether this one should be added to city life or it shouldn't be added to city life. And this is the overview of the proposed model. It's a rather complicated method. So what? Those are the two inputs. So this is my partially observed matrix, so the things that I know about my labels, but only a part of it. This is the network of things, so the hypergraph of things that I do know, but from a different perspective. So those are the, in this case, for the example we had, those are the labels. These are working on the tag relations. So images that have the same tags are now in the same group. We use this incident matrix, so the way of describing my images in terms of do they have this particular tag or not. And then this technique coming from signal processing to create a Laplacian matrix. So you change it to a representation that you can actually easily use within the next step. So this becomes now your graph, or it's captured within a matrix. And this, for now, remains fixed. So it's only the additional information that you gather from something else. And this is the part that we want to optimize and where we want to get better results. So here I have this matrix where I know part of the matrix, and there's a large part, the white part here, which I don't know. So that's the part that I want to fill in with values. So where should I put the values? This is a huge matrix, so it's very difficult to optimize it directly. So what you could do is decompose it into two matrices, or factorize it into two smaller matrices, which combined yield this matrix, but are a much simpler representation. And then you use those multigraph convolutional neural networks. So that's where your kind of learning comes in, where you combine what you have here, so your current matrix, you combine with this matrix that we have as an external, a kind of reference, which helps you in analyzing things. And what you then try to do is to keep this part correct as good as possible. So you want to keep the relations I already have found, those you want to keep, you accept a little error, but not too much. That's what you're trying to do. And what you try to do is to find the kind of simplest matrix that we can use, the simplest description I can have of my whole data set. So what you're trying to do is to find a matrix here, because that's the one that you're trying to optimize, which can predict everything that's there in the best way, given what we have here and given what we already have there. So you want to have the simplest description possible. This is a difficult problem to optimize. So what you do, you start with a first step. So you start with this one, you compute those features, and then you use a recurrent neural network where you take what you currently have and update my result. And then I continue here. And because you have a recurrent neural network, you can kind of also learn from the previous steps that I had. So you take into account the kind of history, how you create the optimal solution here, and you keep it iterating till you are not changing anymore. So we did it on two networks, two data sets. So the first one is the clay data set, which is commonly used in the multimedia community, where you have, in this set, 4,500 images with 99 expert labels attached to all the images. Are they in there or not? 20,000 tags created in 10,000 groups, and there are 2,500 users. So that's the data set that we have. Doesn't seem that big, but I'll show you that actually it is a very rich data set that we're looking at. And we're trying to do a number of things. So we want to do multi-label image classification. So given our tags, we try to find labels for the images that are not there yet. So add labels automatically based on the tags from other users. We want to try to see what users should be connected to images based on connections we have there. Do group recommendation. So based on the tag, see in what groups people are probably participating, and what are interesting tags to add to your, what are good tags to add given what we have there. So again, we're using additional information with a network to predict properties of individual images. And we compared it to a number of techniques. We work with a hypergraph, so having all those groups in there. Of course, you can also say, I take a simple graph, so if there's a connection, if they share the same tag, I just make a link between the images, but not taking into account that you also have groups. I can also use a weighted graph where I say how many things do I have in common. So if they have two tags in common, the score is 2. If they have 5 tags in common, the score is 5. So I give some more structure there. And there's another technique. And this technique is also a hypergraph-based technique, but they didn't use any deep learning. They didn't use graph convolutional networks as a optimization method. And there's a method where they look at social network features of every image with techniques like PageRank or the number of common neighbors. So they just compute structural features of the graph nodes directly. And what do we? So here's the thing that we have. So we have tags and we try to predict the labels. We have tags and we try to predict the users. We have tags and we try to predict the groups. Or we have the labels and based on the labels see whether we can predict the best number of tags. And as I said, it's a small data set. It seems like a small data set with only 5,000 images. But these are the number of relations that we are talking about. So those are the relations that we aim to predict. So there are 600,000 relations among images and labels. There are 90 million relations between images and tags. So you really have a very rich description of data. And what do we use as a training method? So we always use this. So that's the relation between the between the tags or the labels. That's our additional information that we are using. And out of all the possible relations we have here, we take 60% for training and we remove 40% and use that for testing. So we take the 60%, that's how we learn our model, and then see how well can we predict the 40% that actually took out. How well can we do that? And that's there. And those are the results. So here, this is the false positive, this is just an ROC curve. So this would be the random performance if it just be from left bottom to top right. Our method is the one here. So we're happy that we are there. The graph is the black one, that's here. The weighted graph does a little bit better. The old method using using hypergraphs but not using deep learning as a optimization method is here, and you see that the feature-based method really is close to being random on those tasks. And you see similar things happening for the other tasks. So this is when you try to find the labels for the images. This is when you try to find images and their users. So if they are from a particular user, you see that those two methods now become random. We don't do much better here than weighted graphs, but for the other two tasks, we actually do. So we do get better results, and we are optimizing, especially here. So we, at this moment, so here the false positive rates here, you see that the true positive rate here of the blue method starts degrading, and we are still improving on this line here. So there was one use case in which we have tested it. This was another one, and that's where actually officially the money is coming from for this project. So we're working in a European project together with a lot of law enforcement agencies, and they want to look at criminal networks. They want to look at data on different kind of forums than Flickr. And one of the things what we use as a study model is Stormfront, which is a nationalist forum where people discuss all things about racism and all kind of very bad things. You don't want to read most of it, what is there. But what do they have? They have data, they have users, they have pieces of text, they have images, they have avatars, so everybody can be a particular person and you have a little icon showing who they are. Some of them are very interesting to look at. They have a forum category, So they have things like white supremacist, racism, that are the kind of topics they have. And they're part of a national network. So you have a Dutch version, you have an American version, you probably have a Ukrainian version. So they have their own networks in which they are working. And again, what we want to try to do, take one of the relations and try to predict one of the other relations. So one is, are there kind of topics, can you find which users would be interested in that particular topic? Can you learn from that? Can you put a category in the right forum? So where, what would be the category where typically this post should be discussed or would be discussed? Can you predict in which network, in which national network things are added? This can sometimes be very easy because the language might be the determining factor, but it might also be that it's really because similar-minded people are living in the same country. So you can use both as an analysis. And finally, and this is the first one where we started using content. So we look at the profile pictures and see whether we can actually find in what, I think in what forum they are part of. So does your picture that you take as an avatar tell you something about what kind of person that is and where it fits? And that's actually part of another European project where we work with social scientists, and they wanted to know whether females on Stormfront, whether their avatars tell you something about who they are. So they were doing an analysis there, and that's how we could use those things. But what we see here is very similar in terms of performance to the other things that I've been showing. So same methods here, only not the graph-based ones. So the red one is our result. This is the black one is the one where you are using hypergraphs, but not using deep learning. And finally, if you just use features of the network. And you see in all cases, using the hypergraph on top of the deep learning, on top of the graph convolutional network-based methods, really gives better results. And that's also reflected if you're using the area under the curve, you see that it performs better, or the equal error rate, so the one where those two errors become the same, you see similar performance. So you see that the method is actually getting better and see what they are doing there. So summary, social multimedia is now everywhere on the web, and it is a very good way of understanding data. But if you have social multimedia, it does come with a lot of metadata and network relations around it. So we should find ways to properly put those into the analysis and really make use of it, because it is a very useful source of information. The graph convolutional networks as a new model, they really start bringing relations into your networks rather than only pixel-based, pixel neighbors, but really looking at neighbors in the graph-based setting. And on top of that, the hypergraph that we have been talking about, they add this notion of groups in your data rather than only relations in your data. And they help. And, well, we presented a hypergraph-based framework for doing that. What can you say about this framework? It learns the relational information between images and also of the properties of individual images based on the contextual information. So the things, the first part that I showed is only based on the contextual information. It doesn't look at the content of the image at this moment at all. And although it didn't show that much, but the hypergraph is actually a very efficient way of storing the data. It's a very efficient way of dealing with your data. It also turns out that actually learns faster than the other methods. So if you look at the iterations, if you see how the error is degrading or the performance is increasing, you see that the hypergraphs do it much faster than the other methodologies. And, well, as I showed, the method outperforms other methods based on hypergraphs, and it also outperforms methods which are simply based on features of your node based on graph properties. And what we are currently doing, which I, in the Stormfront use case, already indicated a little, we started using the content of the image as well. So using any of the standard neural networks to actually learn the content of the image, be able to classify what is in there, we are now putting that into the framework. Of course, that is a little bit tricky in the sense that your feature descriptor for your content might be 1,000, 2,000, 4,000 elements long. So you are in a kind of different way of dealing with your data. But that's an interesting avenue that we're currently pursuing. And that's what I would like to tell you.
Thanks, Marcel. And we have time for one question. But it will be the best question, I think.
Well, I started late.
Okay. So, please.
So I'm not sure that is really best because it is a slightly technical one. And the question is mostly about that moment when you're moving from Euclidean space to this hypergraph thing. And as I understand, on the picture you had not key uniform graphs. So this means that you have unpredicted quantity of connections there. So the way you perform this convolution, the kernel type you're using is a little bit unclear. Could you please tell a little
yes.
bit about
yeah,
that?
So, I hope you understood. You heard the question. So it's only the idea of using convolutions that you are, the signal processing that you are using. The method is actually completely based on graph-based methods. So what you're using is the eigenvectors of your matrix, the eigenvalues of your matrix, and they kind of are what you have in Fourier-based analysis. So signal processing, you have Fourier transformations where you talk about frequencies and you talk about amplitudes. Those are replaced by the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues. So it's only that the model has been taken over. What it really means is quite different from what you have in signal processing.